Let me introduce to you the first speaker. Julie is the Executive Director of Black Exposed Living. She's a past chair of the Pro-Black Health Care Alliance, a program of the Human Life Alliance. She's a founder and coordinator of St. John's Befrienders, a parish outreach ministry to nursing home residents in Long Island, LPN. She's a nationally known speaker and writer. She addresses all aspects of medical decision making and patient advocacy. She has served as a volunteer patient advocacy for 30 years and was the director of the Center for the Rights of the Terminally Ill. From 1985 to 2003, she has been editing and continuing writing to impose death, euthanasia, and assisted suicide, and inform about dying for critical medical decisions. I think we have copies of that here for you. And they're both HLA publications. She's also the editor of PHA Monthly, that is the Pro-Life Healthcare Alliance. And you have contact information in the resource page behind the schedule. Her articles have appeared in numerous publications, e.g. Ethics and Medics, the National Catholic Biographic Center Quarterly Journal, and various Catholic newspapers and pro-life publications. Her earlier experiences include being a licensed practice nurse caring for the elderly and disabled in the Catholic hospital, birthright volunteer, opening her home as a refuge for unwed mothers, National Family Planning Instructor for the Diocese of Lincoln, founder and director of Pregnancy Aid Office in Tacoma, Washington, and natural childbirth instructor. Julie resides in Bedford, Texas, with her husband William, and is the mother of 5 living children and 2 in heaven, grandmother of 10 and great-grandmother of 2. Let's call her Mrs. Grimstad.
Nurses and doctors and other caregivers who In 2012, a group of medical professionals and pro-life healthcare organizations, or pro-life organizations from the United States and Canada, joined together to create the Pro-Life Healthcare Alliance, which is a program of Human Life Alliance with their office in Minnesota. The reason we came together is because we were becoming increasingly concerned about the inroads the culture of death was making into healthcare. And our purpose, our mission, was to protect patients, to renew reverence for life within healthcare, to protect patients, and to defend the rights of physicians to their, follow their conscience and their religious beliefs. So our main purpose for existing, in fact, is to bring together healthcare providers who are pro-life, educate others to be pro-life, so that in that way we can protect patients. We can't protect patients if we don't have any pro-life healthcare providers left. We have been concerned about the change that is taking place in medical ethics. Historic traditional medical ethics were based on Judeo-Christian principles and Hippocratic oath. You know, now even if doctors take the Hippocratic oath, it's been really watered down. And that is because of the change in medical ethics. The core principle of traditional medical ethics is the sanctity of life. The aim is to protect and preserve life, no matter what the person's condition. No matter whether they have special needs, or they're very old, or they're very sick, we just take care of them. We try to preserve their life, and we, when we can no longer cure, we take care of that person until natural death. That is traditional medical ethics. I graduated from nursing school in 1969, and that was the code of ethics that we followed in. Most doctors and nurses were pro-life in 1969. Unfortunately, I watched a gradual decline, a secularization of medicine. What I call post-Christian bioethics emerged in the 1960s and embraces a secular and a utilitarian ethic, a philosophy. Utilitarianism means that if you're not useful, we can dispose of you. Anything that's not useful, get rid of it. The core principle of bioethics, for the most part, there are some Christian bioethicists, so I'm not condemning bioethics as a whole. I'm saying this is post-Christian bioethics. The core principle is the quality of life. Medical decisions are often based on cost-benefit analysis. Is this person worth the resources that we're using to take care of them? It's not about the sacredness of life, and it's not about the patient's needs or values or wishes. It's about, and this is a direct quote from a physician, we will save your life if we think it is worth saving. In 1993, Dr. Ezekiel Emanuel, who was one of the architects of Obamacare, stated in the American Journal of Medicine, quote, increasingly, it will be our collective determination as to what lives are worth living that will decide how incompetent patients are treated. We need to begin to articulate and justify these collective determinations. In other words, what Dr. Emanuel was saying is that they need to justify medical killing or imposing death on people against their wishes. When you think about that, that's a pretty incredible statement. You know, when Obamacare came into existence, they said it was so that everybody would be provided with health care insurance, especially the uninsured and those with special needs. As you listen today, remember that idea of that promise. If you're familiar with the gun-controlled culture, really not the gun-controlled culture, the gun culture, you know the color code. You know that condition might mean you're unprepared or in la la land. Maybe walking down the street with your earbuds in, not realizing anything that's going on around you. Condition yellow, on the other hand, is that you're in a state of relaxed alertness. You're aware of what's happening around you. And condition orange is when you have identified a specific threat. And then there's condition red. This potential threat has become an imminent threat to your life or to your safety. And because you're not caught off guard, because you're paying attention to what's going on, you have a much better chance of defending yourself and of surviving. So today, I want you to be in condition yellow. And then there are a few times when you need to realize that I am talking about condition red. Don't get caught off guard. Pay attention to what everybody is saying today. Pay attention to the signs that your life may be endangered. I seriously don't like to talk about death and dying. I just don't. It's not one of my favorite subjects. I want to say to people, can't we just talk about something more pleasant? Because I've been talking about this now for 40-some years. And many people are uncomfortable talking about getting old. I did that, and it surprised me. When they got looked in the mirror, there I was, all wrinkled and old, and I said, how did I get here? Most people are like that. I have more years now. But facts are facts, so let's talk. 80% of us, at some point, will have lingering or terminal illness. 80% of us, if we don't die first. Roughly 65 million Americans provide care for someone else, namely a relative, with a disability or a chronic illness. Our greatest challenge today may be to defend life in a culture of death. We need to look at a few definitions so that you know what I'm talking about. Euthanasia, the church defines it as a maternal mission which causes death in order to eliminate suffering. And I always add, or some other problem, because sometimes the person is seen as the problem. But I'm here to tell you no person is a disposable problem. If I become a problem to you, don't dispose of me, okay? Euthanasia by omission is intentionally causing death. Doesn't mean that we can't refuse treatment that is burdensome to us or not useful, it's not doing what it's supposed to do, it's lost its effectiveness. We have a right to make our own medical decisions within the moral parameters that we're going to discuss later. But euthanasia by omission is intentionally causing death by withholding or withdrawing life-sustaining treatment and care. Unfortunately, euthanasia by omission is legal in every state in this country. Even though our advance directives ask, say that they don't permit mercy killing, they don't permit euthanasia, they don't permit suicide, assisted suicide, they do. As long as it is taking away life-sustaining treatment, which includes, under our law, food and water. Euthanasia by action is something like a lethal injection or an overdose of pills. Sometimes it's smothering somebody with a pill. Depends on who's doing it. Stealth euthanasia is a term many of you may not be familiar with, but it means hidden or disguised euthanasia. It's disguised as comfort care or supportive care or pain control. There's one that I particularly abhor, and it is disguising terminal sedation, which is done for people rarely, but occasionally, when nothing else can control their symptoms, and they're agitated and they're in pain. You may terminally sedate a person. That means that you put them in a deep state of unconsciousness, but you can wake them from that state if you need to. But with the kind of terminal sedation I'm talking about, that stealth euthanasia, they sedate a person permanently for the rest of their life. They put them in water so that their life ends very quickly. that is stealth euthanasia. And it's important to distinguish that you can provide pain medication to treat pain, but don't provide sedatives and pain medication to heal. Sometimes patients, their families, or even their physicians don't know what is morally acceptable. They don't know whether or not it's right to stop treatment. That is a real moral conflict, a turmoil that many people have. And so today we're going to talk a little bit about the principles for medical decision making. Another term I want you to be familiar with is assisted suicide. Assisted suicide is when a physician or another person facilitates a suicide. Okay, by providing the means or the information for a person to kill himself or herself. For instance, physician-assisted suicide is when a doctor prescribes drugs for a person to take and kill themselves. The Hippocratic Oath says, I will not give a lethal drug to anyone, even if I am asked, nor will I advise such a plan. No wonder we had to throw out the Hippocratic Oath. Besides the fact that we do abortions in this country, we now kill people at the other end of life spectrum. In the United States, physician-assisted suicide has been legalized in Oregon in 1994, but it didn't go into effect until 1997. But they have the most experience with it in the United States. It was legalized in Washington State, Vermont, and just this year in California. And with this last election, the people of Colorado voted for it. And also, Washington, D.C.'s council just approved assisted suicide in Washington, D.C., our nation's capital, by a vote of 11-2. That is veto-proof. All the mayor can do when it gets to his desk is refuse to sign it, but he cannot veto it. It may go to Congress, and Congress can decide whether or not it is going to be law in D.C. So we need to contact our congressman and tell them to oppose assisted suicide in Washington, D.C. Excuse me. Some people think that it's legal in Montana. A 2009 Montana Supreme Court decision said that doctors had a defense if they assisted a suicide. But the defense was they had to be able to prove that the person had requested it, the person was terminally ill, there were all kinds of other things. And assisted suicide is still prosecutable in Montana. So I don't consider it legal. Another reason I don't consider it legal is that since 2009, the Montana legislature has rejected several bills to legalize assisted suicide. So it still remains illegal in Montana. Montana State Senator Jennifer Fielder asked the right questions in 2013. She said, why was more money spent on promoting assisted suicide than any other issue in Montana? Where did all that money come from? And then she said, could it be that convincing an ill person to end his or her life? Thank you. Will health insurance companies save a bundle? Did they fund the lobby? Then she asked, how much would the government gain if it stopped paying Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid on thousands of people a few months early? The well-funded and inappropriately named Compassion and Choices, which used to be the Hemlock Society, Hemlock is the poison that killed Socrates, you know. They named themselves after a poison. They changed their name to Compassion and Choices because it just sounds so much nicer. But their agenda has not changed. Be aware that their ultimate goal is to transform doctor-assisted suicide into a legal, covered medical treatment in every state. Condition Orange, a specific threat is identified. Here in Texas, we have a very good law prohibiting assisted suicide. Be prepared to defend it. It says, a person commits an offense if, with intent to promote or assist the commission of suicide by another, he aids or attempts to aid the other to commit or attempt to commit suicide. Everywhere should have that law. Suicide discriminates. Assisted suicide discriminates against those who are disabled or very ill. Okay? Suicide is not seen as something socially good in our society. It's seen as something bad, and we do a lot to prevent suicides. Why then do we approve it for people who are especially vulnerable and should be getting every suicide prevention effort we can provide to them? I think it would be interesting, a friend of mine in Canada who's a member of the Pro-Life Healthcare Alliance, Mark Pickup, sent me a cartoon one day, and there was a door to the medical clinic, and all these healthy people were walking up all of these steps to the medical clinic. And on the other side, there was a handicap ramp, and at the top of that, it said suicide clinic. That just illustrates how terribly discriminatory this is. It is telling people we don't think, as a society, that your lives are worth living. So go kill yourself and save us a lot of trouble and a lot of money. My brother Don was a quadriplegic for the last 11 years of his life. He dived into a lake and broke his neck, and my cousin Bob fished him out. They had been in the Navy together. Both of them were excellent swimmers, but Don happened to hit his head on a rock that had not been there previously. For the rest of Don's life, he couldn't move anything below his neck except for one arm a little bit. For the first year or so after his accident, he wanted to die. He tried to kill himself. In the middle of a Minnesota winter when it was 30 degrees below zero, he took his power chair, went out in the cold, and sat there for a couple of hours until he got a headache from the cold because the only thing he could feel was his head. He rolled himself back in and he called and he said, Julie, I don't think I cut out to commit suicide. Okay, but I have no doubt that if somebody had been willing to assist him in an easier way, then that is what he would have chosen. And my brother lived for 11 years. And he had a chance to become a real human being during those 11 years. I can't describe to you how wonderful his life was. I mean, this was a man who was an alcoholic and a gambler, and had left his wife and children. Once he broke his neck, he reconciled with his family. His children came to visit him all the time. Everybody loved him. His funeral, the doors were open to the church because not everybody could fit in, so he had to stand out on the street. That is what giving people a chance to live a little longer to be heroes is all about. Elizabeth Kubler Robbins, my brother has died, and you know. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, in her 1969 book on death and dying, wrote, lots of my dying patients say they grow in bounds and leaps and finish all the unfinished business. But assisting a suicide is cheating them of these lessons, like taking a student out of school before final exams. Suicide is not socially desirable, it's not moral, and it is discriminatory. Now we're going to talk a little bit about advance directives for healthcare. These are legal documents by which individuals express their wishes about medical treatment if they ever are incapable of making their own medical decisions. The first advance directive was called the Living Will. It was introduced in 1967 by the Euthanasia Society of America. Why did they introduce it? Well, it was the first step, they said, towards the acceptance of euthanasia, whether voluntary or involuntary, for the unfit. Sounds like Barbara hard saying, because most of the people who followed this were friends of hers back in 1938. So in 1967, they had failed in multiple efforts to legalize euthanasia, and so they decided to go to the back door and introduce living wills. The first state to pass a living will was California. It's called the Natural Death Act. See, even the names of their bills are confusing. They're not asking for people without natural. Okay. So the goal was the legalization of the right to kill. But an early Euthanasia Society of America pamphlet explained that they were going to promote it as the right to die, because people were readier to accept the right to die than the right to kill. And lo and behold, a number of years later, the Euthanasia Society of America changed its name to the Society for the Right to Die. They're always changing their name to be politically correct or more acceptable or nicer sounding. From that first step of introducing the living will, it took a mere 23 years for the federal government to get it on the act. In 1990, they passed the Patient Self-Determination Act, which requires forces, hospitals, and all other healthcare providers to introduce people to advanced directives. At that time, it was the living will. And the reason they wanted to do this is because that would get people to refuse medical treatment and die sooner. And I don't say that lightly, because in 1987, Dr. Otis Bowen, the head of Health and Human Services, had testified before the Senate Finance Committee that a good way to attack the problem of health care expenditures was to encourage people to sign living wills. Dr. Bowen's speech and the passage of the Patient Self-Determination Act were not coincidental. Every time you're admitted to a hospital, you will be asked, do you have an advance directive for health care? Your answer should be yes, and you should have the right kind with you to give to them. If you say no, they will offer you money. With all that other paperwork you have to do, you're probably under stress, and so you don't know what you're doing at that moment because you're set. And so they'll hand you this document. Do not sign it. In a few minutes, I'm going to tell you what to do. See, I have already gave you a hint. Laws governing advance directives vary from state to state, but I'm going to use the Texas Advance Directives Act because I think that's what interests most of you. We have two kinds, we have three kinds of documents. One's in how the hospital DNR, but I'm not going to address that today. But the other two are the directive to physicians and medical power of attorney. The directive to physicians is a person's instruction to physicians to administer, withhold, or withdraw life-sustaining treatment if they are incapable of making their own decisions and they have a terminal or irreversible condition. A medical power of attorney is much better. It's a document in which one person, the principal, names another person, the agent, to make medical decisions for them in the event they become incapable of making their own medical decisions. But consider how these terms are defined in Texas law. Let's look at one of the life-sustaining treatment. It's treatment that sustains life and without which the patient will die. The term includes artificially administered nutrition and hydration. That's feeding by tube. That's IVs, that's stomach tubes. Okay, so life-sustaining treatment is treatment that you can refuse. And what does life-sustaining treatment do? It sustains life. Without it, you'll die. The law says that. So what's the intent of the law? Now, there's two conditions under which life-sustaining treatment can be taken away from you under an advance directive. One is an irreversible condition. That's a condition, injury, or illness that may be treated but is never cured. How many of us have illnesses that can be treated but never cured? Okay. Which leaves a person unable to care for or make decisions for the person's own self. And then without life-sustaining treatment is fatal. Terminal condition. condition is any incurable condition caused by injury, disease, or illness that, according to reasonable medical judgment, will produce death within 6 months, even with available life-sustaining treatment provided. Okay, so studies have shown that the prognosis of life expectancy are just guesstimates. I have numerous cases I would tell you about people who outlive their doctor's guesstimates and when they might die. And I'm sure all of you have stories because everywhere I go, people come up to me and tell me stories. But my husband's a really good friend that he went to high school with, that he celebrated his 60th birthday with, that we went to Mexico with that to celebrate his 60th birthday. Shortly after that, found out that he had pancreatic cancer. The doctor told him, said, I'm sorry to tell you, we have a month to live. And Larry was fainted right on the spot. You know, he had no idea he was that sick. And so he decided to opt for aggressive medical treatment. He lived for 3 more years. Very happily, playing golf, my golf tournament just about a month before he died. And then there was my friend, Father Dennis Forzola. I was his medical power of attorney agent. Father was elderly, he was on dialysis, and he decided it was becoming too much for him to bear. One of the nice things he said to me is, you know, when I'm on dialysis, I can't teach her to make the soup. So, Father Forzola decided that it was morally acceptable for him to go off of dialysis, and the doctor told him, will you be dead in a month? Father Rosal lived for 7 more years. I don't know anyone who has lived that long who had like 5% kidney function, but I guess where there's a will. So don't sign a living will or a directive to physicians. You can never foresee what you may want or need at that moment. Research has repeatedly shown that people who say they wouldn't want to live like that when they're healthy, want to live like that, want to live any way they can when they become sick, because life is precious. It's never wise to specify conditions under which you would rather be dead, especially in writing. In 2005, there was a Wisconsin case that I could call in on by the relatives. Staff Sergeant Chad Simons suffered a severe brain injury when a roadside bomb went off. He had a living will stipulating that he didn't want any artificially administered nutrition and hydration in the event he became terminally ill or permanently unconscious. Chad's wife insisted that food and water be stopped, and the doctor mistakenly or intentionally said that he was permanently unconscious. He was admitted to the Don and Marilyn Anderson Hospice Center in Madison, Wisconsin, and there he was deprived of food and fluids until he died. Let me tell you what happened before that happened. A family member told me, desperately asking what they could do. She said, when Chad was in rehab, and he would squeeze a ball, and he would squeeze a ball, and he would dropped it and picked it up and wanted to regain his strength. His best friend told the reporter that Chan was answering yes and no to questions, and when he asked him who wanted to live, he said yes. Okay? But his wife wanted him to die. And so he did. And that is because Chad signed a living will before he went to Iraq. And he checked the box on his living will that said, no artificially administered nutrition and hydration. No piece of paper should seal your fate. You need a friend, you need someone to protect you, and your next of kin may not be that person. So if you haven't spoken to someone about becoming your agent, I suggest you do it today. And make sure it's someone you trust. Choose a directive that's not licensed to kill you. The medical power of attorney that you get from the state of Texas can be deadly. Remember, it operates under the same definitions as the living will does. What I suggest is a document that Phil recommended, the protective medical document from the Patients' Rights Council. It limits your agent's authority in one specific way. It says your agent may not approve the intentional ending of your life. And that is for your protection, but it's also for your agent's protection. Imagine the pressure that can come to bear on an agent when the healthcare people want you dead. So another thing that this document says that I really appreciate is the meaning of the words that may be misinterpreted by others are the meanings which I have discussed with my agent. So my agent is the only one who can interpret what I meant. Every patient admitted to a healthcare facility is asked if they have an amendments directive, go with your PMDE signed and witnessed. We're going to talk about some principles for medical decision making, and they are in your packet. And so I'm not going to be real clear about them because I don't want to take time. I want to leave time for questions and answers. But specifically, it's important that when in doubt, that you err on the side of life. Never err on the side of doubt. If you're doubtful, try it. You can always stop it. The doctor needs to discuss things with the patient and his family in layperson's terms, terms that the family can understand, giving them all the information that they need to give informed consent. And then the Catholic and Catholic Church says that it's up to the patient or his legal representative, which is an agent, to make the final decision after the doctor has presented the case. Okay, it is impossible to make morally sound, sensible, informed healthcare decisions ahead of time. You have to have all the facts. You're not clairvoyant. You can't see into the future. So don't sign any document or give any hard and fast instructions to your agent that say when you would or would not want to live or under what circumstances you would want them to take or you would want to live, those sorts of things. Okay, there are two extremes to be avoided. Don't insist on physiologically useless treatment, treatment that will do the patient no good. I've seen that happen, but it's rare. Usually it's they want to take away treatment that is really beneficial for the patient, and they're saying that it's futile. Withdrawal or withholding of treatment with the intention to pace and cause death is always wrong. It's euthanasia. So we need to avoid those two extremes of insisting that people have treatment that they can morally refuse or kill them. So there's two big extremes there. The object and motive of administering pain medication must be to treat the pain. It should never be to kill the patient. And then nutrition and hydration. That's a little more complicated subject. But generally, nutrition and hydration must be provided to every patient. There are circumstances when the body is shutting down, multiple organ failure, the person's near death, that we keep them comfortable. We might, fluids might be building up, we might just give them ice chips, but we do everything in our power to keep them comfortable. Okay? But we do not intend to kill them. That's very important to understand the difference. And on the back side of this, there is what the church teaches, what healthcare providers should do in the event of, I think you have it on the back side of this, I'm not sure. Is it there, Rose? Okay, it's very important that you read these. Healthcare, these are the groups, the ethical directive, of the ethical and religious directives. Guide for making medical decisions for yourself or a loved one and for discussions with your agent. As a former geriatric nurse and a patient advocate, I can tell you people die. They do. In spite of all our best efforts, people die. We don't have to make them die, they're going to die. We are all, I guarantee you, everybody in this room have 100% mortality rate. So, why do we rush it? Because I think the problem is people don't believe anymore that we don't own ourselves, that we belong to God. And he decides, the Lord, and he decides when we die. And even if we're on a ventilator, or a feeding tube, or any other device, we're going to die when God wants us to, when it's our time. So don't worry about whether you're doing the right thing if you're on a ventilator. They can die anyway. You may also have questions about ventilators, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, do not resuscitate workers, hospice, etc. And that's why we have prepared this little magazine that answers a lot of questions for you. Fuel care, medical futility. John is going to address that. I just want to warn you that this is not just a threat in Texas. It's all over the country. Yeah, we have a bad law here, but in some places where they don't have laws, people are killed by fuel care decisions without even knowing that that's what's happening. Fuel care is a threat to our lives that most people don't know may be working in their hospital. Fuel care means that a treatment doesn't work or it's useless. That's what it meant to me when I was a nurse. It was fuel, it didn't work. Now, factors like quality of life and physical functioning are decided, are part of the decision. And that's just not fair, because some people want to live. I have seen people begging for medical treatment and being denied it. I have seen families begging that their loved one have medical treatment and being denied it. What kind of health care providers do that to people who are suffering? Okay, John's going to tell you a whole lot about this law that we have in Texas. So listen carefully to him. And there's one more issue I want to address before I open it up for questions, and that's the Texas most document. Medical orders for scope of treatment. In some places it's called Holster, depends on the state, they all have different names. But in some states these are laws, but in Texas it is developing. What most is a form. It's usually on bright pink or neon green paper. It comes on the first page in your medical records. Okay, this is what it's got on there. It's little boxes you can check. It reduces medical decisions to little boxes. One of the choices is medically assisted nutrition. Offer nutrition by mouth at all intervention level is feasible. But then it says, the first choice you have is no medically assisted nutrition. The second one is, unless medically contraindicated, a defined trial of medically assisted nutrition. And then the last choice is long-term medically assisted nutrition. Thank you. Yes, I hope that works. So anyway, what I'm talking about is a form that gives you choices, but the only one they really want you to fill out is the refusal of treatment. I can read that, and what it says at the very top. Any section not completed implies full treatment for that section. So you don't need this form if you want treatment. You only need this form if you want to refuse treatment. Okay? So this document is only about refusal of treatment. They give you some choices, but that's not what they want. And they will keep revisiting this form with you until you check the right box. Okay, because we now have, this year, January, doctors get paid now for discussing this with patients in their doctor's offices. Let me give you a sample of conversations from the website that teaches facilitators, the people who fill out these forms with you. Let me give you a scripted conversation. And this was on the video that's on their website, on the Texas Most website, instructions for facilitators. And this is the video they watch. Doctor, we don't want to start giving you care that you don't want. patient. I don't want to be a burden on my family or be kept alive on machines. Doctor, what are your goals of care? What kinds of things make your life worth living? The patient said, I just don't want to be uncomfortable. Then the doctor tells her about the advanced care facilitators and said that one can meet with her at the doctor's office or come out to her house and talk to her about most. All choices are presented as morally neutral. The Texas Most form has some very interesting language. At the very top again, it says, follow this most and patient preferences first, then contact the physician. So this may be the last contact when your physician signs this, or a physician, doesn't have to be a physician you have ever met. Any physician can sign this form once the facilitator fills it out with you. Okay, this may be the last contact you ever have with the facilitator or the physician, because they're supposed to follow the most orders before they call the physician. Why is that? It has confusing language. I listened and read some of the things that they have on that website, and I was absolutely appalled. What does it mean? Do you want us to focus on keeping you comfortable? The patient may say, well, of course I do. Not realizing that the clinician means, should we stop efforts to treat your illness and prolong your life and only provide comfort measures? So the language is really tricky. And do the checked preferences. You know, there's no witnesses to this document. You have to have your advance directives witnessed. But there's no witnesses to this document. Whatever happens between you and the facilitator, what if the facilitator doesn't interpret your wishes correctly? Do the checked preferences reflect more what the facilitator thinks you want than what you really want? Was the patient steered toward a certain choice? Did the facilitator, or was the patient told that the most were going to affect immediately? I had a case in Wisconsin with what they call their pulsed form, and a woman had signed a pulsed form, and she had COPD. Okay, she went into the hospital, and she couldn't talk. She couldn't speak, she was having a really acute episode. And she went into the hospital and they were going to deny her treatment because she had said she didn't want treatment in certain circumstances. I said, this circumstance is not outlined in this document. She can survive if you just give her treatment, take care of her for a few days, she can go home. What you're talking about is letting her die rather than giving her the treatment. Because she signed a pulse form. Well, those were her wishes. The woman lived only because I was there fighting for her. There was another nurse in the hospital who was fighting for her too. So we gave up on the people who wanted to kill her. Unfortunately, that nurse later lost her job. I don't have a job to lose. I'm very fortunate. The most form travels with the patient from one setting to another. When a patient who is no longer capable of making decisions has a most form, and for instance, a person might go home from the hospital with most form, or from the doctor's office with most form, she might have a stroke, so there's the orders that were signed by Dr. A, and she goes to another hospital or another doctor, and that's Dr. B, and she has the most form, but she can no longer make decisions for herself. She said, because she's had a stroke. And the doctor's hands are tied because he cannot change the orders on the most form because it's doctor's orders, and he can't change them because she can't give him permission to change it. Now, in Texas, we have this a little better in some places because Texas. The most form does not override your medical power of attorney. In some states, it does. But in Texas, as far as I've seen, it's never. never overridden. So if you have a good agent, you're pretty safe with most of them. Don't sign them. Just don't sign them. If they offer to you the doctor's office or the hospital or whatever, or some facilitator comes and wants to talk to you about it, just say, no thanks, I have a medical power of attorney, or no thanks, I'd rather that my doctor and my family make decisions for me in the moment when I need help. You know, doctor, there is a doctor, Dr. Robert Fine, who works with Baylor Healthcare System, who has told us why we need most in Texas. He says because of the high amounts of unacceptable suffering. Okay, now that doesn't make sense. If that's true, we don't need another advanced directive. What we need is better pain control education for our healthcare provider. And I know that's not true. I know that there's not 50% of patients, as he said, don't have severe pain at the end of life. That would mean they're just not taking care of people. Having disease associated with pain means you'll have to endure unbearable pain. The vast majority of patients can get on an appropriate comprehensive pain regimen and live comfortably and peacefully for the rest of their lives, no matter how long or short that is. So I want to conclude by saying that we've covered a lot of ground. When human beings are viewed primarily as beloved creations of God, life tends to be treasured and loving and cared for. In nursing school, way back when, that's what we were taught. And so that's the frame of reference that I have, and that I'm sure most of you have. Our mission, though, is not so much to defeat our foes, those who disagree with us, as it is to convert them. Okay? So our mission is to go out there and to educate our people. So with all the information that you take from this conference today, you have a responsibility to go out and educate other people. Thank you. I have 5 minutes for questions. Does anybody have a question or a comment or anything you'd like to say? If you do, I'd appreciate it if you come to the microphone. Should I come?
Demise that she and they have also caused unnecessary suffering. And this is, if this existed when my mother died, which was about 10 years ago, these are things that we have to be concerned about, not only for ourselves, but for our families, for our sons and daughters, and those that may be responsible for our care. That's what I'm going to say, and that's what I'm concerned about now. Now they're getting so blatant that it's...
Yeah. Well, they've been taking away the human rights since about 1985, that I first became aware of them. So, anyway, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
I'm sorry, I have a question. I am working for, I'm a licensed professional counselor and registered nurse, and I work for an agency that deals with chronically mentally ill adults, who many of which are psychotic and participate in our day program. And so we now have been asked to fill out with them these advanced medical directives. And so I'm concerned because I was approached by the administration of this organization, and I was told we have a billable service that we can start providing to our patients. And of course, everybody wants to build something because that's how they stay in existence. I said, well, what are we building for now? And they said, these are the advanced directives. And I said, well, I would be very reluctant as a professional counselor to participate in that kind of endeavor, because a lot of our clients here cannot make that decision. They don't understand even what you're asking them. Nevertheless, the organization does now have, for every single person admitted, this form, which I cannot participate in, but they have it in the chart. So the doctor has to sign this form. You know, the medical director has to sign this form. So I think we have to be very careful, because it's very insidious, you know, that these organizations are just slipping under the wire, these kinds of advanced directives. So, you know, I'm going to continue to fight at our agency, but I do think we have to be aware of that. It's a billable service to have this for persons.
Thank you very much. It's been a billable service since January of this year, and so you will see more and more, when you go to the doctor's office, they're going to ask you. My husband went to the doctor's office yesterday for a sinus infection, and they asked him.
Okay, I have a wife already coming to me today. And when we go to the hospital, you know, we sign a paper, you know, if we're doing the surgery. They are not responsible, you know, for whatever happened. So what happened in my case, how can I protect myself when I have to give an admission, you know, if something happened, you know, they are not responsible. How can I protect myself?
Okay, when you sign a surgical consent form, that's very different. Surgical consent form is saying you understand that under anesthesia something hospital is not responsible. There's these things that could happen to you. And they warn you about that ahead of time, so you can get informed consent to the surgical procedure. That is only for that particular surgical procedure. What we are talking about is advanced directives that people fill out refusing treatment. You understand the difference? No, that's not what those forms, those surgical forms mean. Those are simply for while you are having the surgery, okay? But you do need a medical power of attorney. You need an agent who can be there to protect you and to make decisions for you. So get protective medical decisions documents for you and your husband and fill it out. Do you sign a medical power of attorney and give you the power as his agent? Okay, check it out. See what he signed and tell him. He doesn't want in a directed position. Okay.
Okay.
religion.
I do.
Is there any way these can be made known to maybe
yes.
bulletins or something?
Yes, I'll address that.
Dr.